Okay, so here's the deal. There's a marshmallow. You can either wait, and I'll bring you back another one, so you can have two, or you can eat it now. So you can eat it now, or you can wait, and I'll bring you back two. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, I'll be back. Okay, so I have one marshmallow for each of you.
Okay.
Don't eat it.
And here's the deal. You can either eat it now, or you can wait till I get back, and you can have two. Okay?
Okay.
So eat it now, or wait till I get back, and you can have two. And I'll be back in a little
bit. If we wait, you'll give us two?
Yep, if you wait, you get two. Or you can eat it now, whichever you want. Okay?
I'll be back in a little bit. I'm gonna wait.
They're gonna eat it. It's a funky, funky. But we're still not gonna get to. But if you wait until she gets back, she'll give you two. She still won't give you two because you ate it. So I love it. And I didn't eat a single bite of mine. So don't show her, okay?
All right. Okay, so let's open in prayer and we'll get started here. Amen. Jesus, thank you for this time and your word. I thank you, Jesus, that you are working in this church. You're working inside of us, Lord, to do something amazing and help us to be the ones that wait. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so which kid are you? Are you the one that waited? Are you the kind of kid that waits to get two marshmallows? Are you the kind of kid that's just biting a little bit of the marshmallow? I'm going to wait. Are you the kid that's licking the marshmallow? She didn't say you couldn't lick it. Right? Or are you the kid that's just like, forget it. I'm just going to munch the whole marshmallow. Well, I am somewhere in the middle there. I think the younger version of myself was the person that was more likely to eat the whole marshmallow. The older I get, the more likely I am. I'm going to wait for two marshmallows. So, today we're talking about, and we're going to get to that this point right there, that whole video will make sense a little later, okay? Today, we're in a sermon series called Climb the Hill, and we are talking about the different hills and mountains that in the Bible. And so today we're doing the most important hill ever, Golgotha, the hill of the skull, and the place where Jesus came and died for all of our sins. Now, the more modern translations use the word Golgotha. The earlier in the King James and so on used the word Calvary. Golgotha would be the Hebrew word. Calvary is kind of a Latin word. So you have everywhere you look, you have a Calvary something church, a Calvary Baptist church or some Calvary temple, Calvary chapel. You know, Golgotha chapel, Golgotha temple. That just doesn't quite sound the same, does it? No. No one wants to go to Golgotha. It's like, what? Golgotha Temple. What are you doing there? Is that even a Christian thing? Officially, yes, it is a Christian word. So the name of this spot is mentioned in all four Gospels. And that's important because what you got to realize is the early Christians wanted to verify the spot. They wanted to prove the spot that this took place. So they were going through and saying, hey, this really did take place. It was called the Hill of the Skull, so that when people would read the Gospels, they would know, I know where that's at. Yeah, it's in Jerusalem, and that's over there. That's where it really happened at, so that it could be a proven fact that Jesus did die for our sins. So there are two places where archaeologists say the spot was, so it's a little contested, and that we got to understand here, Jerusalem has 2,000 years of a city built on top of it. So, you know, if you look at our small towns or wherever you grew up in, and it changes like the next 20 years, if you go back, you're like, oh my goodness, that remember where there was an old store there? Remember, you know, we always talk about that around here. Remember when there so-and-so was across the street? Well, imagine 2,000 years of that. It wouldn't look at all the same. So we got two places. The first one is Gordon's Calvary. We have two pictures here. Gordon's Calvary. This was Major General Charles Gordon visited Jerusalem in 1883, and he believed that Jerusalem was set up like a body. So at the head would have been the top, the skull, the north side. And so he believed that the other place that lots of them were going to, which we'll talk about in a second, was not the actual place. And instead it was Gordon's Calvary. And you can see in these pictures how it looks like a skull. So with the eyes sunk in, and you know what's sad right now when you go to this place, if you go on our trip to Israel, you go to this place, it is on underneath it's a Muslim village's bus terminal, and on top of it is an Arabic writing, Muhammad is the prophet, and Islam's the only way. So it's called the Shahada, sometimes those kinds of things can be frustrating. But it was owned by non-Christians, and they can put on there whatever they want. But you can still see that site even today, and it obviously looks like a skull. The other place is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Now, that there's the church name for you. Church of the Holy Sepulchre, holy grave. So now Gordon's Calvary seems to be a lot more evident, but the first church believed that it was right here at this spot where the Church of the Holy Sepulchre is at. And you got to realize back in Jerusalem, what they do is they build the ancient crusaders and the times before that would build a church on top of every place. They thought they were honoring it by changing it and putting a church on top of it. Whereas we see that as dishonorable, or you're kind of changing the historical value of it. They didn't see it that way. So we have Church of the Holy Sepulchre here. And the reality is Jerusalem is a modern city, and they're not exactly sure, but both of these sites have plenty of evidence, and I'll let you kind of decide actually or research it for yourself. But now, it is a fact that where the Church of the Holy Sepulchre is at, you can go to the top there, the Romans did crucify people at that spot. There is a hole where they put the crosses. It's just whether Jesus' cross was in that hole or not can be debated. That Romans crucified people there is not debated. Let's just say it that way. Okay, so let's go to Luke chapter 23, and we're going to do a couple verses here, four or five verses. Verse 26, as they led Jesus away, a man named Simon, who was from Cyrene, happened to be coming in from the countryside. And the soldiers seized him and put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. And a large crowd trailed behind, including many grief-stricken women, verse 32. Two others, both criminals, were led out to be executed with him. And when they came to a place called the Skull, Golgotha, Calvary, they nailed him to the cross, and the criminals were also crucified, one on his right and one on his left. Okay. Our next slide, Golgotha is the pinnacle of all the biblical hills. Not because it's the highest, but because it's the most important. What happened that day, the crucifixion of Jesus, was the most important thing that had ever happened in the history of all humanity, or that ever will happen. That's how important it is. And as we're rolling into this Easter season, the spring season, we start focusing on the cross. Let us all focus on it in our spiritual lives, in our Bible reading, in our prayer times, because this is where everything changed, friends. Everything changed. I believe, it's my personal belief, my personal theory, that Golgotha is the center of the world. The center of the world. Everything revolves around that moment in time, that moment in history, that particular place, Jerusalem. Even now, it's so critically important. I believe it's the center of the world. It's where our sinfulness met God's holiness, where history of all time met eternity for all time, because we're going to heaven because of that sacrifice, where God's anger met God's grace, where the Old Testament met the New Testament, and where you and I's lives were actually changed. 2,000 years later, that event echoes on through even our lives even today. But let's go back a little closer here, and let's look a little bit about Simon of Cyrene. See, Simon of Cyrene was humiliated. Okay, he was from Cyrene. He was a Jew from out of town. Now, Cyrene is over 800 miles from Jerusalem. Cyrene is what is now modern-day Libya, North Africa. So there are two thoughts on this, that he was came all the way 800-mile journey to celebrate the Passover for one religious event, which is personally my opinion, or that he was just from out of town, and the fact that he was from Cyrene, but he was from was modern-day Libya, but he still didn't live in Jerusalem. Either way, he traveled to this city for the Passover. And when he gets there, he's surprised to find out that they're crucifying somebody. The Romans did it all day, every day. They were constantly putting people up on crosses. And they would put those crosses on a place of prominent display. Prominent display on a hilltop called the Skull, so that you could, everyone could see, don't want to mess with these Roman guys. Whatever they did, you don't want to do that, right? It's like a public execution, so everybody knew, whatever they did, you don't want to do. So the Bible story says Jesus is trying to carry the cross, but because he had been beaten so severely, which most people were not before they were crucified, because he was beaten so severely and treated so harshly, he could barely walk or move, let alone carry this weighty cross with him. So the Romans, who had the opportunity at any given time, a Roman citizen, a Roman soldier could make you carry anything. And that when Jesus said, if someone asked you to carry something for 1 mile, carry it 2 miles, it was a Roman rule that if the Romans came to you and said, I want you to carry my backpack, even if you were going the other direction, you're now following him for at least 1 mile. You had to carry it 1 mile, and then you would drop that, say, like, you're on your own now, dude. But you had to carry it 1 mile. And then, of course, Jesus said, do the second one out of love for the person, right? So when Jesus talked, when Jesus was coming up there, what's now the Via Dolorosa, the path of agony, when he was coming up there, and all of a sudden the Romans were like, this guy can't carry it. You, get over here. Oh, no. Carry this cross. Now, all the people of the town would not have known that it wasn't him, that Simon, that was being crucified. I mean, they're seeing this guy with the cross come up through town. They're spitting on him. They're chucking rocks at him. They're making fun of him, right? They would have thought the one carrying the cross is obviously the criminal. Simon hadn't done anything. He was totally innocent. Well, in this case, both of these people were innocent, weren't they? Simon is not only extremely inconvenienced into this terrible situation, he's made it look like he's the criminal. He's humiliated about this situation. Shame, embarrassment. But see, our next slide, God uses everything. Everybody say, God uses everything. Let's do it again. God uses everything. Everything. There's good evidence to suggest that Simon was so changed by this experience that he did not know Jesus before this, but he turns into a Christian and goes back and preaches to the people of Cyrene in Libya, is what the history books say took place. So changed by this event that even his humiliation, the thing that bothered him the most, this, out of the nowhere, here he is being humiliated, even that situation was so important that it changed his life and his generation after generation after generation was unchanged. See, God uses everything. He wastes nothing. Even situations that don't look like there's something good, God uses it anyway. You might find yourself, you might be in a situation right now today like, oh, I'm in this situation. It's not definitely not God's will. Hey, even if God didn't initiate it, it doesn't mean God can't use it. Just because God didn't initiate it doesn't mean God can't use it, friends. God can take something that he did not plan and be like, all right, oh boy, that's not what I was hoping to happen. But time out. Let's make this. Let's start to rearrange this. And even something as humiliating as Simon of Cyrene, he goes there to just go to this religious festival. Now he's written in the Gospels. That'd be nice. And he's a person that goes on to have his whole family and whole life changed for the better because of what Jesus did. See this next slide. Jesus kept his goal in front of him. Hebrews 12:2, because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he's seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Jesus kept his goal in front of him. Jesus kept his goal in front of him. Jesus said no to one marshmallow so we could all have two marshmallows. That's what that was. Like, how does that have to? We're working on this. For the goal that was set before him, the goal that was in front of him, Jesus knew, if I go through this now, something great is on the other side. If I go through this situation now, there's a joy in front of me that I'm going to push on through where I'm at now, so the better thing is on the other side. It's a joy awaiting him. The true answer is, Jesus endured the difficulties and all that suffering. Why? Because he had it in his heart and mind where he was going and how important this was to not just him, but to everybody else. Jesus not only redeemed us from our sin, this one act of self-sacrifice provides us a model for our own lives. Not only is it so great that what he did for us, it's awesome, but he models what we are to do for other people. That we need to say no to the one marshmallow so everyone else can have two marshmallows. Jesus didn't just do it for himself. He did it for everybody else. He modeled it for everybody else. Why do we say no to the flesh? Now, here we are. You know, tomorrow's a Monday. It happens after every Sunday like that, unfortunately. Okay, so we got to get up and go to work. We got jobs to do. We got things to do. Well, wouldn't it be better to not do that? Yes, but if we don't do that, then we don't get two marshmallows. Right? So we're all smart enough to know, I would love to just sleep in, but I need two marshmallows. Actually, Lord, make the four marshmallows while you're at it. So we are used to this idea of saying no to what we want now so we could have something bigger later. Why be faithful to your spouse? Because we know that the one instant now will only damage it so we don't have something more beautiful on the second side. See, substance abuse needs to be rejected. Sin and addiction need to be rejected because you're enjoying something now, but you're hurting your future. We say no to selfishness so that we can be a blessing to other people. We say no to things now because it makes the future better. That's why we do that. I don't want the future us to look back at the now us and wish now us would have been more for them instead of them. It's a concept, kind of wordy, but you get my point. Let the future you be like, yes, thank you for saying no to the things of the flesh now, saying no to sin now, having a vision for your future now, because if we have that now, then the future us comes back and says, oh, thank you, instead of now you saying it's all about me and future you being ripped off. We've all been there before, haven't we? I know I have. At a place where we're thinking about now, living in the now, putting now first. When we put now first, we sacrifice our future to our nows. And we got to be the kind of Christians that instead put the future ahead of the now. Amen? I got a story to share here with you of two brothers. It's a tragic story. Two brothers were playing on the sand banks by a river. One ran after another up a large mound of sand, and unfortunately the mound was not solid, and the sand gave way, and the weight caused them to quickly sink into that sand. When the boys did not return home for dinner, the family and neighbors organized a search, and they found the younger brother unconscious with his head and shoulders sticking out above the sand, and when they cleared the sand to his waist, he awakened. And they asked him, "Where's your brother?" The child replied, "I'm standing on his shoulders." So with the sacrifice of his own life, the older brother lifted the younger one to safety. See, that's a tangible story. Literally, someone saying, "I'm going to take and do something that's better for the future than it is for the now." The point, we are standing on the sacrifice of other people. We're standing right now on the sacrifice of Jesus himself. His sacrifice, if we would not have had the sacrifice of Jesus, none of us would be at church, serving the Lord, living for God, giving our hearts to the Lord. None of us would be here if it wasn't for that sacrifice. But Jesus knew it. And for the joy that was set before him, he knew it. And he decided to sacrifice the now so that all of us could live in a great future. Man, that's awesome. We're also standing on a sacrifice of all those who have spent time, money, energy preaching the gospel. They spent their money and their time. I mean, if you think about it, how did we come to know Christ? Well, somebody shared it with your parents. Somebody shared it with you. Somebody took the time and the energy and the effort to build churches so we could have a place to learn about God. Somebody took all that time that we did not put in, and we are standing on their shoulders. And our lives are better because someone had the foresight to go for the two marshmallows instead of the one marshmallow. Someone sacrificed their time, energy, and money so that we could know Jesus, and we are thankful for those people with innumerable sacrifices that we will never know till we get to heaven. There could have been somebody out there that sacrificed to give this or that that you don't even know. Someone got the person that led you to Christ, someone got them saved. Someone built a church so they could go to church. All those sacrifices, friends, were standing on their shoulders. It's okay that we're standing on their shoulders. It's not okay if we're not thankful for it. Does that make sense? As long as we stop and go, thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice. Thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice that these other people have done. Thank you, Lord, that I too am going to be a person that doesn't take the one marshmallow, but instead has enough foresight to do the two marshmallows. May that be us. Amen. Modeled after Jesus himself. So our next slide, self-preservation is the first law of physical life. Self-sacrifice is the first law of spiritual life. Warren Wiersbe, one of my favorite authors. What a powerful thought. Let's think about that together. Self-preservation is the first law of physical life. Self-sacrifice is the first law of spiritual life. If we want to be spiritual beings, self-sacrifice is our first law. If you want to be natural beings, what do I mean by natural? Just the animal part of us. What do animals want? They want a hot rock to sleep on. They want some food. They want to procreate. If you think about it, that's about what most human beings want too. Because self-preservation becomes the thing that they're about. And God is saying, I've got something more for you. You are not an animal. Say no to the flesh, the self, the animal part of us. Say yes to the spiritual part of us that is bigger than that part. So we live in the first law of spiritual life, sacrifice, seeing beyond the moment. So many people, as long as they get the warm rock to sleep on, the food in their belly and the procreation, they don't care about anything else. Well, you and I are not like that, friends. We know in our hearts God wants more from us, through us, for us, and for other people through us. And we're going to live in that spiritual law, the law of self-sacrifice. Now, for me, I have a few things that I, on a personal level, times where I specifically ate the one marshmallow instead of waiting for the two marshmallows. One of them is I really have some regrets about more formal education. And I wish I would have done it. I had a chunk of time where I could have done it, and that time rolled on past me, and I wish I would have done it. And maybe you admit that too. I don't know. Maybe you wish you'd had some more formal education or gone back to school or whatever it is. You know, but that time kind of rolled past, and here we are. I don't think I'd be doing anything different if I had that education, honestly. I think I'd be pretty much on this platform doing exactly what I'm doing right now. But I sure wish I would have had it. Time where I took the one marshmallow instead of going for the two marshmallows. But I've been praying about this recently. And I thought, well, maybe there's somebody out there who knows that I don't have all the formal education of the master's degree and doctorate degree. But maybe they can relate to me because I am relatable. And I'm like, oh, there's a guy that messes up just like me. I can actually do this Christian thing. And if that's my level of modeling for you, so be it, right? Yeah. There's a guy that I can actually do, you know. I've set the bar so low for all of us now. Just kidding. But for all of us, I'm sure we have a time that we can all think of that we grab the one marshmallow when we wish we were had enough foresight to grab the two marshmallows. Well, our hope is that God somehow uses that situation, even in our lack of foresight, that he even uses that situation for his good, because he uses everything. Just like Simon of Cyrene, he uses everything, and he wastes nothing. So it's a dichotomy in today's message, if you're catching it. The dichotomy is this. Know when God wants us to think about the two things and self-sacrifice for the one. But cut yourself some grace and some slack for the mistakes we've made in the past as we look back over our lives wishing that we would have grabbed the two and the future version of us instead of the one at the time. Those are the two elements we want to make sure we got in our heart today. Now, for each of us, as we grab a hold of that new thing God's got for us, may the wisdom of God, the love of God, the grace of God, the Spirit of God lead us so that we know when the time is that we are being called to give up the thing that's now for the thing that's better in the future. Amen. Our application slide here today. Jesus put his eyes on the prize to get something better. He was the model for that. So what do you need to do to sacrifice now so that later you can have something much better? Today we're thinking about that thought right there. What is the Holy Spirit speaking to you right here today that you need to be thinking a little bit down the road a little further? Maybe you've been thinking about all what makes you happy, your hot rock, your food in your belly, and God's saying, get up. Get out of that mentality. Get to the first law of spiritual life, self-sacrifice. And get past the first law of natural life, self-preservation. Hopefully the Holy Spirit's been speaking to you in this time, on this teaching time, where there's some things rolling around. Yeah, I got to start thinking a little differently. Yeah, I got to let go of some stuff. I got to let go of some attitudes. I got to let go of some things because that's not taking me in the right direction that I need to go. That's not taking me in the direction God wants me to go. And I'm holding on to this thing now. And if I can let go of that and get into the future, I'm going to change my life and the life of those people around me, just like Simon of Cyrene did, just like Jesus did with the model of his self-sacrifice. Amen. If I could have every head bowed, please, and every eye closed at this time, every head bowed and every eye closed.